Hello everyone, and welcome to this RCS Exchange talk. Thank you for joining us this evening. Tonight's BSL interpreter is Yvonne Strain. Her video will be visible throughout the talk and during the presentation. She will be shown on the right-hand side of the screen. You can scale this screen by hovering over the video and using the arrow. So when we go to share screen, you can go ahead and adjust the size of the screen in relation to the speaker's rectangles. If you require closed captioning, the link to access this is in the chat. So do check the chat as the link to closed captioning has been posted as you were waiting. For the duration of this webinar, the participants, that is yours, cameras and microphones will be turned off. So if you would like to get in touch with any questions or thoughts that you have, please use the Q&A function, which you will find in the bottom panel of your Zoom screen. And if you really agree with a comment or you really want a question answered, then please do use the upvote function that'll move that comment up the screen, and I will kind of be able to see those ones first in this. So please do take part if you feel like you would like to. And also, if you would like to tweet about tonight's event, then please do so. And you can use the handle at RCS underscore the exchange. And that has been placed in the chat for you now. All right. So my name is Josh Armstrong, and I am a lecturer here at the Conservatoire. And I'm also the artistic director of Objet-a Creative Studio, who is the publisher of a series of publications that is part of the Becoming series. So what the Becoming series is a collection of publications that are kind of creative research projects that look at the interrelationship between humans and ecologies, so kind of other bodies. Our first publication was called Becoming Botanical, and that explored the interrelationship between humans and plant life. So really looking at the intersection of where nature and culture meet and what that means in our society currently, speculating on futures and also reflecting on our pasts. So that publication was published in 2019, and currently we are working on the second publication in the series called Becoming Feral. So what this project is looking at is the relationship between humans and other animals, and really trying to explore the contested categorization of wild, feral, and domestic. And that is something that we'll be exploring this evening, because instead of giving a kind of a talk or a presentation or a paper on these ideas, what we're going to be engaged with tonight is a creative conversation between myself and the three other managing editors of Becoming Feral. We're currently in the revision stage of the publication. We have already selected all of the entries that will be in this publication. And for the first time, we're going to be launching a digital collection as well, because being a performance maker myself, I was really keen on finding ways in which performance artists can take part in something that is mainly a print publication. So we're going to be launching a digital collection with multimedia works as well. And I'm very pleased that with the kind of opening of this project into multimedia, we have received quite a few works that really show performance in action. So kind of looking at these ideas of kind of feral performance, which we will get into this evening. So without further ado, I think we should invite up my colleagues onto the screen. If you can open up your cameras here, and we will say hello to you. Great, fantastic. It's very good to see you all. Now, we did have a kind of a pre-chat earlier, so hopefully things will go all smooth and we still have things to talk about. We always have long lists of things to discuss in our meetings together. So I think just to begin with, I wonder if each of you could kind of introduce yourselves, also maybe say geographically, kind of where you are, and also tell us a bit about yourselves and perhaps your relationship to kind of our project in kind of the feral or even in the wider sphere of kind of ecologically concerned artworks. I will pick on you, Chessa, first.
Great. Hi, everyone. My name's Chessa Adsit-Morris, and I am the assistant director of the Center for Creative Ecologies that's housed at the University of California, Santa Cruz. But I'm currently speaking to you from Vancouver, Canada, on the unceded territory of the Musqueam people. And I was lucky enough to work with Josh and Alexandra on the first publication, Becoming Botanical, although I didn't have as much time, so I was only able to write the introduction. So I'm very excited to be more involved in this Becoming Feral. And I think particularly most of my research is in the sort of intersection of environmental education, ecological art, ecological thought, and posthumanism. And I sort of started playing with this concept of feral subjectivities in research I was doing from 2015 to 2017 that I published in a book called Restoring Environmental Education. But then I kind of had to drop that and work on some other things. So I'm very excited to be able to work on this Becoming Feral project and go a little bit deeper into some of the ideas around ferality and feral in this time.
Great, thank you, Chessa. Maybe next we'll hear from Rebekka.
Hi everyone, my name is Rebekka Saeter. I am currently in Oslo, Norway, which is also the place I'm from. I'm an artist and an outdoor educator, and I'm the artistic director of an interdisciplinary art project called Ghosting Glacier. And this project explores ways of being and interacting with a melting glacier in relation to climate change and also perhaps psychological issues that we try to suppress. So we as a collective, there are two musicians and a photographer and me, we explore what happens in that encounter of bodies and beings. And my initial training was in choreography, and then I educated myself within outdoor education. So my practice in both fields are sort of always playing around somewhere in between and trying to find connections and understandings and new ways of knowing. And I'm very much into this encounter way of perceiving and knowing. And so ferality fits very well into this whole mishmash of interests. So I'm very excited to be here and a part of the publication.
Thank you, Rebekka. And finally, Alexandra.
Hi, everyone. I'm Alexandra Lakind. I am currently in Santa Fe, New Mexico, which is also called Ogapogay in Tewa territory. I am I work in environmental studies and education, but in recent years, a lot of that has been on ecological arts programming. So I spent several years doing a citywide program around kind of art in the Anthropocene, or artists exploring a new ecological epoch. I am also an alum of the what used to be called RSAMD, but the Conservatoire, in the same program as Josh, the Contemporary Performance Practice Program, and have maintained my own kind of practice that is differently engaged in questions of environmental kind of relations. In the first series, Becoming Botanicals, I worked on that with Josh at the same time as doing a project in Chicago around kind of, it was called Gardens for a Changing Climate, around kind of public programming across the city around gardens and climate change. And have been really excited about Josh leading me on this feral turn and kind of moving in this direction and taking on new ideas and new concepts that seem to very much be in the air. I am leading a research group right now at the University of Wisconsin-Madison called Feral Worlds, which is deeply connected to this project. So we have some faculty and several graduate students who are now working on the project with us, which is really amazing. So Becoming Feral has now grown to include many contributing editors. And we've really been able to, with all of our kind of thinking through how to make this a more intimate process, been able to connect with them and let that help deepen our conversations, but also they're paired individually with contributors. So when people kind of submitted to Becoming Feral, they were then, you know, accepted, some were accepted and paired with editors who some of them are us, but some of them are actually paired more intentionally with contributing editors to really talk through their ideas and kind of go deeper into the concepts that they began to explore in the texts they submitted. So I'm very excited that we've been able to, yeah, engage lots of campuses and communities in this project.
Great, thank you so much, Alexandra. So I think, you know, it is a good point to mention that Becoming Feral, the publication and online collection, is being kind of supported by the University of Wisconsin-Madison and the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland through the Research and Knowledge Exchange Athenaeum Award. So it is a really great kind of partnership here, kind of across the Atlantic, kind of exploring these ideas. So let's dig into kind of the key kind of ideas that we are looking at this evening. So as I mentioned, the format of the event is going to be a bit of a discussion, kind of a meandering track, probably a series of complications of what feral is and what kind of feral performance is within that. And so the first kind of complication or provocation might be the title that I came up with for the discussion this evening. And what is the feral turn? What does that mean? When I was thinking about how we place and situate this work within performance, I was really thinking about all of the work that has gone on in relation to art making in the Anthropocene, or in this epoch of kind of human industrialization, really. And in reality, the Anthropocene is not new. Yeah, it kind of began, as Timothy Morton would say, began with the patent of the steam engine, and then began again with the first atomic bomb dropping in Japan. And these are actually kind of geological events that have occurred. They're not anything we're making up. They're not kind of questions of whether or not it's true or not. It is literally new layers of carbon and radioactive material that have been deposited at the result of human interaction. And so when I was thinking about what we're doing in terms of really kind of this work in addressing the Anthropocene, so we've been making art in the Anthropocene for kind of 100 years, but actually what are we doing now that is actually addressing it. And I was thinking, perhaps it is this idea of the feral turn. And so what that kind of really looks at for me is this idea of kind of decentering the human, also an act of kind of a de-domestication of the human and of decolonization, because it's inherently our human involvement in the world, our construction of it, has altered things. And that is definitely through through our kind of domestication, through our colonization of the planet and of its kind of other animals and variety of bodies. So in some sense, this kind of feral turn is recognizing the agency of other animals and all kind of more than human life. So we kind of see that touching on ideas from Jane Bennett's looking at kind of vibrant matter, you know, and the agency of more than human bodies. But the other kind of aspect of the title of performance after the end of the world really also goes back to kind of Timothy Morton and a bit of Donna Haraway, when we're looking at the idea that with the birth of the Anthropocene also ushered in the end of the world. So the acts that will lead to the end of the world have already happened. And so actually, what does performance need now? Or what do we need now as a society, as humanity? Not to save the world, but what kind of stewardship do we need to address now during this epoch, after the end of the world? And we don't necessarily have answers, but what kind of tonight is going to do is we're just going to kind of pull some threads that are coming out of all of these entries that we've been submitted. So we are working with about 70 submissions that we have in this project. And actually 70 sounds like a big number, I think, but actually that's only 60% of what we received. So we received a lot of submissions, and actually through receiving submissions, we've begun to think about how we curate the collection. And through curating the collection, I think we've begun to draw out threads of understanding of what this feral turn might be. What does it mean to do a feral turn, to kind of recenter ourselves in a different way? So that's kind of what we're going to be exploring tonight, with some examples from the collection as well. But before we do that, I'm going to ask Chessa to maybe dive into a bit about what do we even mean by feral. Picking on Chessa because she decided to write a book with the word feral in the title. So so we'll give it to her as the expert on the subject.
I will do my best. I think one of the interesting things is where we started. I think we're building off of a lot of work that's already been done within the sort of discourse of the Anthropocene around the construction of wildness and what it, that has done to contribute to the projects of colonialism and capitalism. And so this project is really looking at, well, what does the category of the feral do and allow us to do or doesn't allow us to do, and how does that either contribute or challenge, you know, these existing projects as we move forward. And so we kind of, in the call, we're kind of playing with what does it allow us to think? So this idea of feral epistemologies, who does it allow us to be, sort of feral ontologies, and how does it allow us to act? So how does it allow us to take up and embody feral subjectivities? I think is sort of ideas of how we're exploring. And so I think through this book project, it's not necessarily defining it, but exploring what it, what the capacity for this ferality to allow us to do at this particular historical moment. Yeah, anybody else want to jump in? I'm just trying to think. And it also has a lot to do with human control and thinking about, I think when you're talking about the end of the world, a lot of the pieces we've recently been editing have to do with grief. And so, and ferality, you know, the definition of ferality is sort of moving towards wildness, out of human control, but also this idea of grief and death and how that is also out of human control and how we're kind of having to come to terms with that. So I'm really interested in performance and art as a way to grapple with those different types of things and play with, particularly with the art process, which we'll kind of dive into as an act that then, you know, has a life of its own in moving forward. So, yeah.
Great, thanks so much, Chessa. Yeah, definitely, you know, I think one of the kind of the key things that we're trying to grapple with in a way is that it feels like there definitely is a spectrum on this categorization of wild and domestic, and kind of feral belongs somewhere in the middle of that, you know, because in some sense, feral doesn't exist without the domestic and without at least a myth of the wild, one could say, in today's societies, like kind of existence, you know, is the, does wild exist to an extent, or, you know, or, you know, as we spoke earlier, is everything feral now? You know, is there no more kind of something untouched by domestication in some way? Yeah, so definitely really interesting. And I think it's good to point out that we are kind of working with other kind of thinkers at the moment globally. You know, one big project people might know about is Anna Singh's work, Feral Atlas, which also has an extraordinary array of contributors on that as well. But I think in some ways, the difference between our work and Feral Atlas is that that's really centered on infrastructure and how human infrastructure changes, shapes, and actually can create ecologies that are beyond human control anymore. So it's thinking of how, you know, how a highway can be human controlled, but actually how does highway become something beyond human control? And what is that impact on the wider ecologies that it becomes a part of? And our work is really centered on this relationship between animals and other animals. I'm not animals, sorry, humans and other animals, you know, within that. And in some ways, maybe we are getting down to what you were saying there about control, you know, thinking about this as behavior. We're really, really exploring behavior more than anything else. Even though one could argue that infrastructure is built on behavior, but perhaps without the stuff, we're looking more at the relations, which actually leads us on really well into kind of the first of our findings. So I'm going to go ahead and start sharing the screen here, if I can figure out between my different screens how to do this. So our emerging themes that we're finding are these four here that we'll kind of dive into, but just as an overview, the themes are feral relations, feral acts, feral collectives, and feral futures. Now, I do realize we don't have an extreme amount of time, so we'll see how many we get through. And if not, you can definitely find a copy of the publication when it's ready and enjoy the multimedia collection online this summer. So let's kick off by thinking about these ideas of feral relations. I've been speaking a lot. I wonder if someone else wants to speak briefly about what feral relations encompasses. Chessa, do you want to pop into that one?
Yeah, I think in thinking through these different categories, feral relations are really looking at the context of human and animal relations and looking at it in a sort of, yeah, in a content way, not necessarily as an act or as a performance, but what is it kind of, what do these relations allow and how do they, you know, come about and what are those relationships? And it really kind of resonates with a lot of the work on sort of multi-species encounters that are becoming really popular right now to explore and that kind of stuff. Do you want to play the Raven piece?
Yeah, I will do, definitely. Yeah, so this So this first piece is an excerpt from one of our submissions. It's called Raven's Reprise, and you can see on your screen, written by George Finlay Ramsay and music by Rudy Zagaldlo. And really, this is a piece that is kind of an intercultural adaptation on one of the creation myths from the Northern Pacific indigenous cultures, kind of set also in contemporary time. So we'll go ahead and listen to this, and then we can have a bit of a response to it from the editor's grounds. This is Raven's Reprise.
The end of the world. A recap, in case you'd forgot. Start of the world, things were V dim, because some greedy gut, i.e. Lord Fatberg, was hoarding everything. Raven did a clever trick, became dust in Fatberg's daughter's breck. Daughter got preg, Ravesky the baby, bawled something awful, till fat old Berg gave her 3 bags to shut her up. Contents. Moon. Stars. Sun. She threw them out the smoke hole, and world begun. Or so they say. Flash forward to 2020. End of the world is where we're at. I doubt you'll doubt that. Ob's Raven, she's got another plan. Flies circumpolar, then lengthways wise, well, basically everywhere, gathering stuff. Beak to IKEA bag. Arrives back at Fatberg's condo. He's drunk on gin. Snore, drool, perspirate, an ugly scene. Raven, huff puff, drags heavy blue bags to the walk-in closet. Fatberg wakes, catches glimpse, thinks. Ah, phew, that bampot's returning all my things. With third bag in, he pulls a ploy. Wakes up and bawls, get that shitting black bird out of here! Raven, with fright, jumps out her skin, craps all over, and escapes up the extractor fan. The fat lord laughs, a bone tenderizing crease, then goes to check his stash. Horror. Oh, fuck. Oh, crap. Oh, tits. Bag one. Micro beads spill out and stick to everything. Bag two. Ching ching. Bitcoin clogs his whole pad. But I divested in 2015. Bag three, hot air. Fatberg melts. End of.
Grand. Great. So that's an excerpt there from Raven's Reprise. And I wonder if there's any, responses from the editors in that in relation to feral relations. Anyone?
I guess I'll jump in and say that one of the things that I think is exciting in that is I think many of the ways that people engage with kind of the idea of nature, right, as something outside, is that there are a lot of works being made that kind of mystify that or put it at a distance and make it seem like it's kind of a mythical other. And I feel like this work really shows that we're in a moment, like you said, where we're kind of maybe everything's feral and everything's connected to these ideas. And there isn't kind of an outside of a conception of a Protestant nature. There isn't an outside of a capitalism. You know, there isn't a way that these things interact without infrastructures, without kind of Bitcoin, without those things. And so to me, I think this helps show, like you said, that feral is built on the domestic and the idea of wild. It's built on these relationships that we have to that, these relationships to home or to nation or to ideas of what is inside or outside. And to me, I think this work does a nice job of showing all of that coming together.
Lovely, thanks, Alexandra. I mean, I think one of the wonderful things about this is that while we have these categories, in some ways, every different entry kind of explodes even our categorization of it. So this is one very particular idea of of these feral relations, but I'm also thinking, you know, we have lots of entries that are looking at our relationships with other animals. You know, one of the key ones is our relationship with pets, you know, so about kind of dogs and other kinds of companion species, about loving for the kind of emotional and kind of psychic relationship with pets, whether that's a turtle, you know, or a cat, you know, or in some instances, the kind of, you know, like the feral pets. So the what, you know, the kind of the wild animal that continually returns to your house, you know, and it kind of becomes part of your understanding of your position in the world. You know, so really there's kind of a wide range of what these relations are. But I think also what this one points at as well is our relationship with myth, with kind of mythological animal as well as something outside of ourselves, but still kind of holding this kind of otherness in itself. And actually one of the repeating kind of entries we were getting were on ravens and crows, coyotes, dogs and wolves, as kind of the main kind of two, and cattle. So interestingly, that kind of the repeating ones were these kind of three categories that really work through this, then maybe they kind of imbue or are imbued with these kind of ideas of transcendence or kind of really kind of firmly rooted in domestication and agriculture in a way as well. But let's move on to our second category so we can get through these and kind of maybe pique people's interest as well. So the next category that we're moving into is feral acts. So feral acts are really looking at kind of the embodiment of de-domestication, or kind of a blurring or a complication of this idea of domestic and wild. We've chose an example. So I think we should just dive into this example and then talk about it afterwards. So this is a piece that's kind of inspired by a colony of army ants. It's called Swarm Raid, and it's music by Anna Lindemann, and the film is directed by Anna Lindemann and Ryan Glista. And we are just going to show a bit of a clip of this, and I think it'll be posted in the chat as well if you kind of want to watch it in full quality afterwards.
Thank you.
I'm going to pause us there. As I said, I believe that a link will be posted in the chat if you wanted to watch kind of the rest of that at this point. Yeah, I mean, in some ways, in what we're exploring in terms of feral acts, it feels really, really rich in relation to, you know, it's looking at the ways that ants, army ants, gather food by releasing pheromones that makes them move into a straight line while they're moving the food kind of between the colonies to kind of adorn the kind of queen ant with the food in this. But also there's lots going on in terms of kind of human behavior and domestication and social norms as well. I wonder if any other responses from the editors there.
I can jump in. I think feral acts is a really interesting category. And it really gets into, I think, what you were mentioning earlier around behavior and then the really like importance of what behaviors count as wild, what count as domestic, and how that sort of almost gets you considered feral, you know, like, but also thinking about performance and art has a feral act. I think that's one of the categories we were thinking about. A lot of the submissions, it was almost like there was one with embroidery where she embroidered a bunch of cats, but it was outside the normal way you would sort of construct an, you know, embroidery. So playing with the boundaries of what is traditional and how you can kind of move outside of those as a feral act is just really enticing for me to think through. As well as we had some other performative pieces that I'm thinking of one of the coyote pieces where she took a bath with the corpse of a coyote and thinking about what is socially acceptable, what is not, how it makes us feel and how we react to those things. I think a lot of people have personal experiences with sort of feral animals and how it makes you uncomfortable or comfortable or being able to predict. So that also kind of connects back to human control. Just thinking through these different types of things. But then I was also thinking about different categories. So like in the scientific world, we kind of categorize behaviors as either competitive or collaborative. So I think a lot of these, we were talking about the idea of play and playfulness and different types of acts that are outside of those categories and how we define and think through relations and feral behaviors. So yeah, there's so much in this to unpack, I think.
Great, thanks, Chessa. And I think, you know, I think that leads us on really well to the next kind of category we have, you know, thinking about collaborative or competition, which is this idea of feral collectives. And actually, what happens when the human and the other animals kind of collaborate together on an artwork or on an agricultural project, you know, et cetera. So I think we'll play the next piece and then we can maybe dive into a bit more of what this might mean to have a feral collective. So this next piece that we're looking at is on Bos Taurus, which is kind of cattle. And we'll have to get Rebekka after the piece to tell us what this Norwegian word is here, but I believe it means kind of collaborator. So really we're looking at the boss cow, so that's the kind of the lead cow in a herd, and their collaboration with the shepherdess. So this is a piece which is a kulning, which is a Swedish kind of shepherdess song that's used to kind of communicate with the cattle in Sweden, and we'll explore the kind of overarching kind of Scandinavian culture of that just after. So this is a piece sung by Caitlin Vitali Sullivan, and the image you'll see is of Grimsmaker, Sweden.
Mm-hmm.
All right, there we are. So that was a cool evening. So in terms of collectives, we were talking about this kind of these feral collectives as, you know, in some regards being very kind of embedded in our culture. And we have another submission about kind of a feral collective with another cow that's actually from Norway. So it's interesting that we have kind of two Scandinavian countries kind of submitting works that are based on a collaboration between human and cattle. So I'll point over to you, Rebekka, in terms of, you can give us any indication of why this might be.
I was just, because there's so much sort of history in this type of singing as the Norwegian equivalent of this, kulok, is one of the nine folk vocal traditional music. And I was thinking when I was reading how the artist that made this particular piece, how she learned how to sing this way. And the way that she learned this was the woman who taught her, she said, well, you have to let the forest guide you, or you have to let the forest inform you on how, what you should express. And I was just reflecting on how this perhaps reveals how Scandinavians can relate to this idea of nature differently from perhaps a British understanding, in the sense that in Scandinavia we have something called friluftsliv, which basically means free air life. And if you compare that to British adventure, which is perhaps has roots in, you know, the conquer of mountains and roots in imperialism, I'm not going to go into all of that. But in Scandinavia, the idea is that you go not out into the unknown and you explore, but you go back into where you belong. And I think getting back to the idea of becoming feral, I think one really thing that can happen is that when artists engage with these cows, for instance, or a cow, you are confronted with these cultural constructs that are there. And you cannot really control what happens in the encounter or the interaction with the animal. And I think it's a great way to really learn from that, in a sense, or deconstruct these binary understandings of wilderness and domestication or nature culture, in the sense that in the past you would have a way where you wanted the animal to perform or behave a certain way. And as an artist, even though you have to produce something which is also rooted in something else, there's a different motivation to engage. And I just think that this may lead to something really, really interesting that we can talk about.
Great, thank you so much, Rebekka. I'm just going to stop sharing for a moment there, and I would love if there's any questions to come in, or any kind of thoughts that you want to post there, and we'll kind of respond to them. We've got maybe a couple minutes there to do that. Now, there is a fourth category of feral futures, which kind of maybe leads us on instead to say, you know, the future life of this publication and project is that it is to be launching this summer. So definitely kind of keep your eyes out for this publication, and definitely for the digital kind of multimedia collection. Looks like it's going to have about 20 entries in it that will be kind of online completely free for people. You know, and there'll be some crossover between the print publication and the online collection as well. But I guess there's no questions coming in yet. So while we're doing that, I guess we'll just maybe touch on kind of the very kind of one of the last things that was coming up in terms of this idea of feral futures, which is really thinking about not only the digital kind of representations, and when we think about kind of feral, kind of when something leaves our control. So we think of something like AI, but we also have kind of submissions coming in about kind of evolution and what happens between animal, other animal, technological evolution, and what is the relationship between those. But also something that's coming up quite a lot, and comes up a lot in ecological work in general, does have to do with indigeneity and indigenous cultures. And I think this feral futures kind of section also points to this idea of what is the temporality of feral. You know, is feral something that happened that we're kind of pining for? Is it a kind of hopeful return to something? You know, or can feral be a future oriented event as well? I guess I wonder, maybe we'll go with Alexandra. You live in sure. kind of New Mexico, so there's obviously lots of kind of resonance
yeah.
there as well.
Yeah, I think a lot of the submissions help kind of explore the way that in constructing the feral as something other than or out of control, it's been used as a racializing discourse in order to kind of maintain and sustain continued displacement of native populations across the globe, including, you know, in particular in, you know, we've had submissions from settler colonial countries like, you know, Canada and the United States and Australia, and places that are really trying to understand how kind of the idea of domestic or control has been completely tied up in a hold on maintaining this imagined past in order to sustain for lack of a better term, within the US, a white future. And so I think that we've had a lot of submissions that are trying to deal with that and try to understand global movements, try to understand this idea of like invasive species, or how we deal, you know, we touched on the blackbird and how we understand kind of imperial ideals within this. So I do think that that's coming up a lot. And I think it's coming up a lot because we deem people with disabilities, we deem children as out of control, as feral, as unwanted, in order to deny consent and access. And so I think that that has come up in a lot of our entries and people submitting, in some ways, even just trying to, one of the ones that I think we've been struggling with is trying to reclaim it too. And so how do you deal with those histories when these are constructed terms? So yeah, I think it was a lot more submissions than we expected dealing with that.
Yep, definitely. Yeah, I think, are there any other, Chessa, you've unmuted. What would you like to add to that?
Yeah, I was just gonna say, we've also been, there's also quite a few submissions dealing with extinction and de-extinction projects, and grappling with sort of the, I'm just blanking on the term, but the sort of the ethical implications that in doing intersectional work, it might not be sort of commensurable, right? Like decolonial work is not going to be commensurable with de-extinction necessarily. So how do we move forward with sort of these uncomfortable alliances, if that makes sense, which is also an interesting way to think about the feral, right? Like, you're not coming into a mutualistic relationship, but it's a relationship that's kind of always kind of on the edge, always being negotiated, but might not resolve, right? Like, so it's almost like sort of Donna Haraway's term of staying with the trouble in thinking through feral, and it is not collapsing. So like, that's a lot of what we've been talking about, is we can't collapse all these things down into each other. How do we grapple with the differences? Which I think is something that's really useful in this concept of feral, is how do we live with the tensions, if that makes sense, and how do we stay with the trouble, which I think is important when we're moving forward and thinking about the future.
Great, thank you, Chessa. All right, well, I think that is drawing us to a close, unfortunately, because I think we could kind of chat a bit longer about it all. But really, in some sense, we are kind of, you know, towards the middle beginning, really, of a process and understanding all of this work. And actually, it's a real kind of, I have a lot of gratitude for everyone who submitted to us, because actually, this is kind of a research project in which you kind of have an idea, send it into the world, and kind of hope that people will get back. And actually, in some sense, the difficulty to articulate what is coming in terms of their cohesion, is actually the really strength of this, because actually, you know, we're really wanting to dig into these contested spaces. And actually, in these contested spaces, in a lot of respects, that's where kind of performance has always kind of found itself, is in these contested areas between categorization and trying to find a voice that fits it, you know. And I think that a lot of this work has been really wonderful to receive and to look at and go, this feels really important, but I don't know where it fits. And actually, I think that is part of this ferality, is going, we don't need to find neat places for things, we just need to make room for them, you know. And I think we've been really kind of exploring all of this ideas for it all. So we're going to kind of end up there. So kind of last thing for me, if you are really interested in becoming feral, then you can you'll find more information in the kind of coming weeks on the Objet-a website. So that's objeta.org. And also we'll send out things through the RCS internal comms if you are interested in the project continuing and how you can engage with it later. But thank you very much, everyone, for joining us this evening. Thank you very much to my colleagues and managing editors here, Rebekka, Alexandra, and Chessa. Thanks very much to the BSL interpreter, Yvonne Strain, and the closed captioner this evening has been Laura Harrison. So thank you very much for that. Of course, thank you to Research and Knowledge Exchange team for organizing all of this term's events. And also thanks to the events team as well, because I know that you are doing a lot of work these days in this digital world. If you'd like to, please follow us on Twitter at @RCS_theExchange. Thank you, audience, again for tuning in. Now, this was the last exchange talk in the series. The exchange talk series has ended now for the academic year, but the Research and Knowledge Exchange Department will be hosting Picha Kuchas by the first and second year doctoral researchers on Monday, the 12th of April, and Monday, the 19th of April. There will also be a special exchange talk co-hosted by the Scottish Education Research Association on Monday, the 26th of April. Details can be found on the Exchange webpage, and a link has been posted in the chat. And lastly, a link will also be posted in the chat on a short survey on this term's exchange talks. We would be really grateful if you could give us any feedback on the exchange talks and the series. So please take a moment to fill out that survey on SurveyMonkey there. So lastly, another kind of farewell. Thank you very much for joining us, and we look forward to finding you in the future. All right, thank you very much.